My name is Bruce Bunch.
And can you tell us what your role was at Lyndon McKinley, that you were a teacher, and what years you were a teacher, and what did you teach?
I started there at Lyndon McKinley in January 1970. And I was through 1971. I taught black history. But it was really, it was history classes, but the black history was the main one.
Okay, and can you, I guess, tell us a little bit about your experience teaching there?
Well, for that year and a half, I felt like I was teaching 20 years. It was something that I wasn't expecting, but it was nice with the kids. It was beautiful, but it was the other things that took place that just took a toll on me.
I see. And when you were brought on to teach there, when you were placed there, what was how was it presented to you, that placement?
I was told that a teacher was quitting, and I was replacing this teacher at Lyndon McKinley in social studies. So that's all I knew. So when I went up there, they put me in the social studies class.
If you don't mind telling us how old you were at the time when you started teaching there, and then also, and that's if you're comfortable. If you're not, that's fine. But what was your awareness of the political and social turmoil that was happening in the country in that time, in 1970, 71, and what were your feelings about it, your thoughts about what was happening?
Well, I think I was 22 when I first, 21 or 22. And of course, I was a product of the 60s, the latter 60s and 70s. So I was very conscious of what was taking place. And coming from a black college, you know, I was prepared for anything. And my mindset was to come in there and teach the only way I knew how to teach. And that was to confront the situation that the country was facing. And my job was to make the black kids aware of what was taking place, not only in Columbus, but everywhere. That was my purpose.
I see. And you mentioned coming from a black college, so I'm glad you said that. Could you talk a little bit about your background, where you are from, where you grew up, and then what, you know, your pathway up to the point where you came to Lyndon McKinley to teach, where you went to school, and et cetera?
I come from a city that was named Chillicothe, Ohio, and it was a little town. School was mostly white. And there was nothing as far as black-oriented type of classes or discussions in the school. My background there was such a way, like, I played basketball, and for about 2 years, I was the only black player on the team. And I had a confrontation on the court one time. Is playing a school called Piketon, Ohio. That's the southern part of Ohio. And I was on the court, and all these white people started hollering, like, calling me nigger, nigger this and nigger that. So the coach, you know, to his credit, he just made all of us just get off the court. We quit playing. But, you know, being in that environment, that really got me prepared to, you know, like, whew, this is racist right here. And so Once I left there, got out of there at the high school, that's when I went to Central State, and it hit me hard. You know, I had to turn my mind completely around as far as what I was going to be confronting later on in life. And that was my blessing with Central State. And you're having black teachers, that's the first time I really had black teachers. They were my mentors, period. As far as what my life is today, I owe everything to those people.
Sorry, I was mute there for a minute. And just so you know, when you're answering, I'm gonna be on mute so that we don't want our voices or our sound to crisscross.
Okay.
So would you say your decision to go to Central State was a product of the environment that you were in, where you were the only, the only black player, one of the few black people at your school?
I had a couple of friends that were going there. Because I had wanted to go to Ohio University. But they said they didn't have a scholarship to play basketball there. So then I went to Central State and I played 1 year at Central State basketball. And, but like I said, it was my friends that got me to go there. And once I got there, you know, I wasn't leaving.
I see. So then, by the time you get to Linda McKinley, can you talk about your awareness of what was happening around, what your thoughts and your feelings were about the political and the social climate in the country and even in the city, if you want?
Okay, there was, it was a time in the country where, you know, was Martin Luther King and his philosophy and Malcolm X and his philosophy. And the way I was, my mind was Malcolm X. You know, I didn't mind marching, but I wasn't the type that, I felt like marching, if they were going to be sicking dogs and beat me upside the head, I wasn't going to retaliate. It wasn't going to be no thing. I was going to take it, go to jail, and be happy. So my philosophy was following Malcolm X as far as how you confront people and be treated and all that. And that's what I took with me when I started teaching. Well, when I first went to that school, you know, like I told you, I didn't know why I was there as far as replacing this teacher. And one of the kids, the black kids, a couple of them came up to me and said, "Boy, we're so glad to have you, see you." So I said, "Why?" And they said, "Well, there was the teacher they had was an older white lady. And like the school was just becoming black. I mean, really. Not taking over, but just becoming black. The kids from that Windsor Terrace area and all that, they was bringing them up there. So she wasn't prepared for that, not at all. And one day she made, the statement, something about, "Why are you blacks and niggers laughing all the time?" And the black kids just went off. So that's when I guess the administration felt like, well, she got to go. So they got her out, then here I come. But I didn't know all that until I got there.
Right, wow. that changes things, huh? So can you talk about a little more about the racial makeup of Linden when you were teaching there, and you said the school was becoming black, and can you talk a little bit about the transition or the shift that happened? I don't know if you were aware of what was, you know, what it was before you got there, but in that year you were there. And then tell us if you felt racial tension at the school or in the community.
No, it was, you know, when I got there, it was, I think it was mostly white students. It might not have been most, but I did have some white students in the class. But, I couldn't give you a percentage what it was at that particular time. I just know it was becoming more and more black, and the white people were moving away. And when I got there, the vice principal, Tom Brown, he also was in some, he had some other businesses. And he was in real estate, and he said it'd be good to live in the neighborhood. And he sold me a house, but it wasn't in South Linden, it was in North Linden at that time. And most of those people, there was a black person beside me, and most of the other people I think were Italian or white people in that area. But I wasn't paying no attention at that particular time. So it wasn't I wasn't thinking about black and white at that time. I just know I had, most of my students were black, but I also had some white students. So that's just the way it was.
And then did you feel that, or were you ever aware of black students being treated differently than white students? And there's, whatever that was, but also could you talk about the relationship that the administration had with you and with the black students, the black community?
Well, I realized the situation with the black students my second year. I started in January. So my second year was my first full year there. And I noticed, especially when I started to teaching the black history. And then I would have discussions about certain things, and the kids would talk about the relationship with some of the other teachers at the school. And it came to a head with one of my students. This young man was, he was a football player, and he came in, you can kind of tell that, he wasn't going to take no mess. I guess it might have came from the way his family taught him, I don't know. But sometimes I've had to kind of calm him down, but he was just brilliant as far as I was concerned. And I can recall one time we was discussing about the terms that during slave time that they'd like to call black boys, black males boy instead of their name. And I was discussing that. So this young man was having a problem with this white teacher, math teacher. And I found out later that he went to the class and he never got along with this teacher. And the teacher couldn't deal with it. And when he went in one day, after I had been had that discussion about that boy thing, and he said, "You late? Where you been?" So this young man said, "Well, I'm here now." And the teacher said, "Boy, don't you talk to me like that." Now, the young man remembered what we had discussed in the class. And he went up and knocked him in the jaw, knocked the teacher down. So they wanted to suspend him, kick him out the whole 9 yards. I didn't know until after maybe a day later what happened to him. So I went to the administration. I told him, I said, "Look, this is what happened in our class. And when that teacher called him boy, it was a reflection on his mind to what we was talking about. So, if you want to get on him, you might as well get on me too." I said, "I know it wasn't right for him to hit that man, but for you to kick him out and as much potential he has, you're doing him a disservice." So they gave him a suspension, I think, of 5 days, and he still remained at the school. So the black assistant principal, Tom Brown, he was saying, we had a white principal. And he couldn't understand what kind of things I was talking about, me and the other black history teacher, Gary Davis. He couldn't understand what we were talking about. How was I talking about, what was that subject coming up in my class about boy? So Tom was trying to explain to him what it was all about. So Tom was saying, Boy, we got to educate not just the kids. We got a problem here with some of these white people. So I said, I understand. He said, but keep doing what you're doing. So when he said that, you know, it wasn't no problem for me. So if I would have had another principal or somebody else, it could have been a problem. So I just kept on going. Me and Gary Davis, the other teacher, we was rolling for the whole year.
And so with that, can you talk about how your presence, along with Mr. Davis, how the presence of both of you affected the students at the school, particularly the black students?
Well, when they wanted to have me and Gary teach black history, when I got there that January, they had already had a white teacher teaching. So they wanted me to observe it, and I went in and observed it, and she was teaching. You know, I mean, it was good to me. I mean, she was talking about Africa and stuff like that. So then that next year, they wanted me and Gary to, the principal, the vice principal, Tom Brown, he also had graduated from the college I went to. And he was asking me, did I know anybody else? And I was telling him about Gary. Gary was a year behind me. So he got Gary to come up here. So Gary, Tom was trying to get as many black males and women teachers at that school because he saw the population change. He was looking ahead. So when I went and observed the teacher, I said, yeah, that's good. So that next year, they wanted to have black history taught to more kids. So she had recommended, she said, well, because I was teaching it in my other social study classes. So the kids knew what was going on. So she said, well, let Bruce take it. And then I said, well, you know, I said, probably going to have to get somebody on. And I said, why don't you get Gary? So they got Gary. So they thought maybe they was going to get maybe a couple kids taking it. So in my class, I had 48 kids. So I ain't had no chairs. We ain't had no books. Gary had, I think, 35 or 38. So we was thrown into this just like that. And me and Gary was talking, and we was trying to get as much material as we could. So my thinking was, they wasn't expecting these kids to take it. So we was on our own. And then finally they brought this, they gave me a person from Ohio State to help out. She was coming up there. She was helping, she was bringing material. I mean, it was like, when they would come to class, there wasn't no chairs empty. They was always there. And it was just a pleasure. There's so many kids wanted to learn about that because they weren't getting it from no place else. So, you know, that's how it all got started.
That's incredible. That's incredible. That hunger, you know, that's wow. That's very powerful too. So at Linda McKinley in that year, in 71, there was a group of black students who got together who had some things they wanted to change at the school.
Mm-hmm.
Were you aware of that group, and they formed a black student union?
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk about your memories of those students and if any of them were in your class?
I can't give you the whole what that group was in total number. But I think that group, most of them was either in my class or Gary's class. And one of the main leaders, John Wells, was in mine. And I think the other one, John Whitaker, was in Gary's. But we had other students who were part of that. I know I had a young girl named Valora Washington, just brilliant. She was part of that group. And some of the things, they wanted the attitude of some of the teachers to change the way they was treating them. And they wanted to be able to have discussions to talk about different things as far as affecting the school. and what black students could accomplish, more things to get them geared toward college, you know, that type of thing. They really had a nice agenda. They wanted a room by which they could discuss these things. I know that came out of it at the end. So they had, and this was on them. You know, I mean, they wouldn't come to me or Gary. This is what they wanted to do. So yeah, that's about all I can remember on that.
Were you aware of the fact that they met regularly outside of school to talk about these things also?
John would tell me. And he would tell me they was meeting, discussing different things. And I said, well, that's good. I'm glad you're doing that, you know. Keep it going. Yeah, he told me.
Okay, so I'm going to move a little bit into 1971.
Mm-hmm.
So were you at the Black History Week performance in February of 1971? And can you tell us what happened? Describe what you saw.
Okay. This was the first time, I guess, they had a Black History program. So it was me and Gary put it on. We had help from other teachers. You know, it wasn't just me and Gary. And Gary had a choir because he directs a choir at a church in Columbus. So he was over the choir and they was singing. We had different skits. So at the end, I was the one that was to close it out. So I walked up in the auditorium and I looked up at the balcony. That's when I saw these white kids started throwing paper watch and all that type of stuff down on the bottom where the black kids were. This is before I could even close it. I saw that. So when the stuff started hitting the kids, the black kids just went off. The white kids, so when they talk about riot, it wasn't started by the black kids. It was these white kids. They took off and ran out the balcony. And as me and Gary was talking about this not too long ago, they had cars waiting on them to get them away. Because if them black kids would have caught them, they would have just been burnt. But that's the way it ended at there. So that's when one of the administrators, I forgot, might have been Tom, or somebody came up and was trying to calm everybody down. But, you know, it's almost like if you at home watching TV and somebody just busts into your door and changed the channel, you look at them, are you crazy? This is my house. What are you doing? So them kids just went off. And it was chaos after that until they got them calmed down. And that's what it all got started from. A peaceful assembly.
I'm sorry. Did you have a chance to see the flyers that were dumped over into the audience?
No. I just saw them tossing stuff down and was hitting the kids, you know, in the head and all that type of thing. I didn't know what they was throwing. I just know they was tossing stuff. They didn't like the program. I don't know.
Did anyone ever tell you what was on the flyers?
No. I think Gary might have said something. He might have saw something that was on, but I didn't see it. Yeah, but I don't... I might have saw it then, but it just didn't register my mind now.
Mm. But what stands out is the fact that it was the intrusion.
Right, right. I didn't care what they threw. You know, they could have thrown the Bible down there. I wouldn't care, but they just disrupted everything else.
I see. So then a little bit later in the year, in May 19th, were you a part of the march from Linda McKinley to Franklin Park to the rally to celebrate Malcolm X's birthday?
Yes.
And can you talk about that, what your role was, and who all was involved? And I think you mentioned something about Linmore students joining
okay.
in also.
It was set up where we was going to have a march to go to Franklin Park from Linden, celebrate what you just indicated, March 19th. So kids were supposed to sign up and put the name, got the permission from their parent and all of that. I had this great big booklet with all these kids' names. And we had, you know, other teachers was with me as far as helping, taking, marching these kids. So I'm marching, walking, and all the kids was behind or in front, our teachers in front and in the back. All of a sudden, I see all these kids coming from Linmore, elementary kids, the parents, they was coming from everywhere. We have, I mean, young adults was joining the march. So I'm thinking, where are these people coming from? And, I mean, you know, if you're aware, you know, like if it was from Duxbury, where the school was, to go to Cleveland Avenue, to take Cleveland all the way down to Broad Street, that's a heck of a walk. And then to take it all the way down to Franklin Park off of Broad, all these people. So, I mean, it was just fantastic. And then when we got down by East, some of the black students wanted to stop and they wanted the kids from East to come. But of course, the principal of East, Mr. Jack Gibbs, he wasn't letting them come out the door. So we had stopped there for a minute, and then finally we just walked across the street and went to Franklin Park.
And what was the rally like there? What can you describe what that was like?
They just had different people speaking, and they was happy for, you know, just to celebrate Malcolm X Day and all of that. We had a lot of different adults that was talking and was trying to encourage the kids. What they had just did was something worthwhile. They appreciated it, and for them to take that in their memories for the rest of their life, what they did, that was a beautiful day, as far as I was concerned, you know. I was just tired.
And why do you think so many others joined like that, and others of all ages?
I think sometimes it hits your mind what you're saying. And people realize that they are now doing something with the kids, for the kids, and it's something that they never had experienced themselves. So they was enjoying it too. They was learning just like everybody else. And to take some of the things that Malcolm X stood for, independence, you know, thinking the way he did. I think they took that into themselves and started saying, you know, this is what we can do ourselves. We can act like this. We can do this. We don't need it to be dependent upon other people telling us what to do and how to do it. And you know, the message was, you know, tell the kids to graduate, make sure you go on to further your education, or if you get a job, don't take no mess off nobody. Just do the job the best you can. And be yourself.
And would you say that the march was peaceful?
Yes. I mean, wasn't no fighting. You know, wasn't nobody pulling no gun out, nothing like that. They wasn't cussing each other out. It was, yeah, it was peaceful. I think that meeting was called because, you know, Linda's in the Linden area and they wanted to go to the church and have a big discussion because they wanted, you know, the people wanted their kids to go back to school and finish, graduate, you know. And they didn't like it. I don't, you know, sometimes people get the impression that black parents don't care for them. their own kids. So that's totally stupid. You know, them parents wanted their kids to be treated just like the white kids being treated, especially when they knew that their kids didn't start it. So, and the blame was being put on them, their kids. So I think when they had that meeting, they wanted some people to start doing something. Just get these kids back in school. Just get everything going back. So they had all these different people coming in there meeting and trying to solve the problem. You know, I mean, you had some, like Mr. Clarence Lumpkins, he was just a beautiful guy. He was what you call a person that would calm down everything. And he was, you know, he wasn't called the mayor of Linden for nothing, because he knew what was going on. And he used to talk to me all the time about that. So him, we had politicians that was coming, and, you know, Les Brown was there. Some city council members, people were there talking, trying to solve the problem. Then all of a sudden, you know, I don't know if it was the kids. I think it might have been some of the kids. They wanted to march up to Linden and put the black flag up. And that's when we went.
I'm going to interrupt you right there.
Sure.
And ask you, when we spoke before, you talked about some of the students at that meeting being very upset about the school being, quote, occupied by the police.
Yeah.
Can you talk about that a little bit?
You know, it kind of reminded me of like what's going on today with Trump sending these troops in, these federal agents into these towns to gather up all these young people and all that. If, you know, going back now, it looks like it's almost like to protect the white students from the black students, we need police in your building. I'm looking at that now, because it wasn't there to protect the black students. You know, to me, it was, we want some type of discipline there to keep y'all in check. And the only way we can do that, we got to have the police there. We don't want no more violence as far as anybody hitting up on a white kid. And when you look at it simple, that's what it boils down to.
And how prevalent was that? I mean, was that happening? Was there racial conflict happening a lot? And was it always one direction?
I'm gonna tell you,
what was your sense?
After them kids threw that stuff down, even the white kids that didn't throw the stuff down, it was almost like they was getting messed with. And if I was white, you know, I don't even know if I would have came back during that period of time. Because it was, I don't know, it was the fact that, and it wasn't necessarily the black kids that was involved in trying to help out the school. This is when you got kids, I'm not saying they didn't care about the black issues, but this was their opportunity to show out. You know, I'm not that type of teacher that believe, you know, that you can save every kid. Because if the kid don't want to be saved, I don't care who I am or what I say, they ain't going to be saved. So some of them kids, they saw this as an opportunity to pick on white people. Now, if they would have got those kids in check, we could have went on back to having the school the way it was. But no, they want to put it all on the so-called black student leaders. Now, you just can't do that. Just, you know, like if you say to the kid, hey, kid, you can't hit this white kid, get out of Linden. You out. But no, it was a thing that we are always at fault. And they look up on us as, I still say, you know, they look upon us as being second-class citizens. You have white teachers was blaming the black kids. They didn't like those kids that was having those meetings. And when the other kid, white kids got big, they wanted to put it on them, but it wasn't them. You know, those kids was having meetings. They was trying to come up with constructive ideas to make the school better. But you had some of them white teachers wanted to throw them out. And every time they would have those meetings, you know, they would always call me out of my class to come to those meetings and wanted me to give them input on this. And, you know, I'm not the principal. You know, I just want, let me get back to teaching. You know, that's your job now. You, why you want me and Gary to come all the time? So, you know, that's when it got put in the paper and all that, that me and Gary was the vice principals, and we was making decisions on this and that. I wasn't making nothing. You know, that's my first year there teaching. What can I do? So, no, it was the police. They didn't, you know, like, you know, I guess they was put in a bad predicament themselves, but you had some racist police there. They didn't like the, you know, they didn't like, and, you know, like, hey, they didn't like that they're, maybe they're white friends, then maybe they knew some of those people that they was getting beat up. So they weren't going to put up with no mess. They would come into our different rooms. This is when we didn't even have kids. They look in my room, and of course, I had all these black pictures in my room. Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, Elijah Muhammad, Angela Davis, Harriet Tubman. It was all over the room. And they would walk in there, and they would look, and I could tell that was just making them upset. So it didn't bother me, you know, because I know, because one day one would come in, next day two would come in. I'm just sitting there. Next day might be three. So I started thinking, and I said, well, you know, let me get a couple more black pictures and put up. So I got a couple more that I threw up at, you know, that they didn't recognize. Then I knew, then they started whispering, like, who? I knew they were saying, who is that, you know, all that type of thing. Eldridge Cleaver, H. Rap Brown. I throw them up in the middle of there. That wouldn't say nothing, you know. So, you know, this was the atmosphere we had with them police around. You know, it's almost like they was just looking to find an excuse to grab a kid, a black kid. And then I look at it now, because I ended up teaching at East. I found that's where I wanted to go from the very beginning. And I ended up teaching at East. And I remember one time we had an incident. This is when we started bringing police, security guards, or, you know, not security, but the police into the schools. And I remember, this was Henry Scott was the principal. And they brought in the policeman, this white policeman. This white policeman, the black kids was walking, going to the class, the bell would ring. And someone would be late. And this white policeman started grabbing the black kids and saying, you know, you hear the bell? He would grab him, and one time he grabbed the kid and put handcuffs on. And this man wasn't there for 3 days, and Henry just said, man, you got to go. He got him out of East so fast, it wasn't funny. But that just reminded me, I started thinking, that's what them type of guys would have probably done to the black kids at Linden if they was in the school at the time that they was there. They would have been grabbing them right and left. So I'm saying, this man, this history kind of repeats itself. The way they cheat. And then, you know, you wonder why the black kids today have no respect for the police with all the shootings we have today. The same thing. So it's been going on for a long period of time, the attitude that you have.
So I want to ask you, when the police were coming to your classroom and looking around
yeah.
and everything, did you feel like they were, that the intention was to intimidate you? And the second question is, you mentioned something when we talked, one time we talked, and you said that at one point the police were following black teachers and that there were police, people told you that police were asking for you.
Well, that was, Well, when they came in the room, like, I think they wanted to show off their friends, you know, like, this is what this man is teaching these kids. Look at these people, you know. That didn't bother me worth a damn, you know. You can go get anybody you want to come in. But when we would leave to go to lunch and all that, word was that, you know, like, it wasn't the police following us, it was the FBI following us. Because a couple people was telling us, yeah, the man, we go to eat lunch, they be following certain people in their car. Because we would always go somewhere and say, hey, man, look at that car. That car's been going following us. Yay. So I knew, you know, it was a little more, it was deeper than just having the police around. Because, you know, like, this school was closed down. I forgot the last part you asked me.
You mentioned that people told you the police were asking for you.
Oh, okay. This was the day that I don't even think the kids were around. And the police was still there in the school. And there was a man named George Mills. He was the head basketball coach. And George Mills was like a mentor to me. And his job was, he got kids jobs. And he knew that since they weren't coming, he wanted to check on the employers. So he had some kids that, this is the time we had Northland. Lazarus was at Northland at the mall up here. And he asked me to go with him to go up here and check on them, talk to the people and let them know that the kids would like to still come to work and blah, 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 that. So we was gone for maybe about an hour or something like that. So we got back, all hell had broken loose. Black teachers were, I guess some white teachers got arrested too. But they was, the police didn't like the way they told them to walk or something like that. And I remember a couple of them grabbed them. I think even the sister principal, I think Tom Brown was a handcuffed. So after all that had happened, a couple of the black teachers were saying, Bunch, they was looking for you. You know, I said, well, should have came up to Lazarus, that's where I was. So, you know, I ain't nothing I can do about it. But that was the attitude. That was the attitude that they had. You know, they knew me.
Did that happen during the exam period?
See, this is the problem that I thought we was just out. The kids was not there. The police was there to make sure wasn't no kids coming in to school. And this was just, you know, like, the teachers was just going in the rooms and just being there at that particular time. And I don't think the police didn't like the way that certain teachers was moving, going through the hall, something like that. I don't know what it was. Because like I said, I wasn't there.
Okay. Okay, so let's go back to the meeting at Bethel. So after that meeting, can you tell us, what are your memories of the flag being switched? You said that after the meeting, there was a decision to go to the school and fly the red, black, and green flag. So can you tell us, walk us through that, what happened and what you saw?
Well, it was a lot of, you know, mostly it was the kids that wanted to do that. So we went up there to the school, and it was a hard time trying to get in. So a couple kids kind of figured a way to go up here on the roof and put the flag up. And I mean, I remember Les Brown and some other people being there around, and you know, we was gonna go through the motion of saying the pledge, black flag, pledge, and all of that. So finally one of the kids got up here and they put it up. And then word got around that the police was on. Someone said that they got a call that the police might be on their way. So I knew there would have been a whole bunch of people would have been going to jail that night if they had got there on time. But we just put the flag up, and it was up there, and then everybody scattered and got away.
Around how many people would you say were out there? Was it a big crowd? Was it students and parents, or students and adults?
I know it was students and adults. It was, to me, it was a pretty nice sized crowd. Because a lot of them, especially the kids, because they came up from that church up Cleveland Avenue and went up there. And everybody, you know, I guess they was fired up. So it was a pretty, mostly, I think, I want to say mostly the kids, but there were quite a few adults up there that was observing. Yeah, it was nice.
And what was the reaction once the flag was flying? Well, how did the crowd react? But also, how did you feel?
Oh, man, it was nice to see the flag up there. I mean, it was to see what the flag stood for and then finally see it put up at a school like that, you know, and relieved, it gave you a feeling of, you know, hey, this, at least we accomplished something at this school to have that flag up there one time. Just one time. We didn't say it got to be up there permanent, but we put it up there one time. And everybody was happy to see it.
What does that flag mean to you?
Well, not only the, you know, the blood and the, it's something that represents the feeling that we have about ourselves. Because, you know, all the words in American, you know, the Pledge of Allegiance, you know, that does not apply to me. You know, that's, those are words, as far as I'm concerned, that's for you. That's for you people. Because when I try to utilize one of those words, I get knocked upside the head. So don't even come with that. But the black flag represents an independence in the mind, something we have hope for, something you can say, hey, look, you know, tell the young brothers and sisters, look at that flag and pay attention to it and start following what we want you to do in life as far as being a black person in America. It represents all of us. And, you know, I mean, ain't nobody going trying to burn down the American flag or nothing like that. But until you start saying, okay, it represents us, well, we're going to make it represent you, the black people. We're going to start following the guidelines that you say it follows for them. Until that happens, you know, it don't mean nothing. I think they got somebody went up. I think someone got up there, went up there, and when they saw the came out early that morning or something, I might have one of the custodians take it down. I don't know for sure, but it was. I don't remember seeing it.
Okay, and then that next day at school, can you talk about the police raid that happened during the school? First of all, there was an assembly, an unauthorized assembly that was called, and I don't know if you were there for that, if you could talk about that, and if you weren't there, if you could just talk about the police coming to the school and what happened, what you saw.
My memory on that particular day is kind of vague because I was in the classroom and all this stuff was taking place. I thought, you know, down on the first floor or the kids, they were saying, was getting beat and was throwing them out the door and couldn't get in the door and the police was jumping on. Now, I ain't seen none of that. I heard about it afterwards, but like I said, I was in the room. I had kids in the room, and I thought they might have made an announcement or something like, don't let anybody leave the classroom or something like that. So I'm assuming that was what was taking place. I don't know if one of the kids got smart with the cop and it took off from there. That they started grabbing kids, but I didn't see that. So I don't know what went on and stuck what brought that on.
I see. And was there any other time when you saw the police confronting students? Mm. You talked about seeing at some point chaos and police body slamming students and Mr. Brown on the ground?
Now, No, no. I never saw a policeman body slam Mr. Brown. When I'm saying, when I got back, I said, I thought they had arrested Mr. Brown when they was after that day I left. And they started messing with the teachers. And I think Tom was saying, like, you know, what's going on and all that. And they was kind of coming off on him, like, we're doing our job and we're too butting in and all that. And Tom said, well, I think he got on if he got smart with them, so they arrested him or put handcuffs on him. So, but I never saw no policeman body slam a kid or Mr. Brown. Tom can tell you that. He knows what went down.
So then the day when you were in your classroom was on the second floor or the third floor?
I think the second floor.
Second floor?
I think.
So that day when you were in your classroom and the stuff was happening on the first floor, mm-hmm. that you didn't see,
mm-hmm.
after that day, what was the rest of the school year like? Oh, I know, man. That was pretty close to the end of the year anyway, right. But what was it like after?
Oh, man, they didn't know what to do. That's when they started having meetings and all of that, you know, and we need to do something. And I can recall, like I said, they was always asking me to come in these meetings. And I remember this one time, and they wanted to call me to come to a meeting, and this is with my Black History class. You know, and this is my class. You know, like, why you bothering me on this class? Get me on something else. No. So I wasn't too happy to be going to this meeting. So I went in there with the attitude, you know. And they was discussing about these kids was wanting a room, and I remember John Wells was talking to them about this room and all that, and they act like they couldn't do it and all that. So Mr. Reed was the principal, and he was saying, I don't know if we can do it, blah, blah, blah. All of a sudden, John Wells said, Mr. Reed, don't your son go to West High School? Man. Reed looked at him, and Reed called the meeting off. Next thing I know, them kids got that room. They got that room. Because Reed was worried about them kids going up there and messing with his kid going to West. So that's the one, and that's why that meeting kind of stands out, you know, when they was, and that room was down there by the cafeteria where they were supposed to be able to go in there and discuss different things and all of that.
Sorry. So do you have any memories of Charles Ross?
Charles was like my mentor. I mean, he would come up there and we would talk. I got involved in some things because of him. And I remember when when my wife started having kids and Brother Ross was always talking to me about, you know, like, hey, man, you know, like, kids. I hope you name after Africa. Give him an African name. So me and my wife, we got a book and all of that, and that stood out. And all my kids got African first names, you know, all three of them. But Charles was like, to see him, the way he operated and talked, I mean, he was like a junior Malcolm X. Take no mess, you know, and come straight out at you. I like people that are not phony. And there's nothing phony about Charles Ross, to me. I mean, some people thought he had some wild ideas, but to me, you know, like, hey, we've been suffering for all these years, and what he was asking for, we overdue to get him. So, no, I ain't got nothing bad to say about Charles Ross.
Okay, thank you. And you also mentioned back when you were talking about the meeting at the church, you mentioned Les Brown being there.
Yeah.
And I wondered if you could talk about him a little bit and what his involvement was in the lending community, or, you know, with the issues that were going on.
Oh, Les was, he was a true warrior. I mean, his advice was always pro-black. Always pro-black. And he was at that church meeting, and he spoke, and then he went on. I mean, what Les said, he backed up. And he went up to that, when we had the flag thing, Les was there. And he participated like everything else. So, I mean, you know, we had people during that time, like I said, they wasn't phony. They were always helping us. Dr. Kelsey from Ohio State, he was another man that always wanted to do things to benefit the black community. I remember we would have a thing on Saturday morning on Livingston Avenue. Dr. Kelsey was behind that, passing out different fruits and baskets. That's where I met another bad brother, Nomo X, who I met over there, because Dr. Kelsey got Nomo involved in that. It was like every once a month, we would go over there and pass out to the community these bags, but that was Dr. Kelsey. So you had people like that, and I remember Charles Ross would come up to Linden, he brought up Jim Robinson. Now, Jim Robinson was the executive for Lazarus, black man. I mean, being an exec, man, Jim Robinson, he could come up with a plan that was just out of sight as far as what black people should do. Another man didn't, you know, come straight at you. So I was surrounded by people like that.
And just for the record, could you explain who Les Brown was for people who may not be familiar with him?
He was at the day, he was the DJ on WVKO. And he would come on the radio. And he was talk just like he did normal, you know. Nice man, you know, but didn't pull no punches. But I guess he's the number one motivator in the country.
So you had this support system of strong minds.
Oh, yeah.
And strong community presence.
Right. I mean, you know, you look out today, you wonder, are we talking to the ghosts? Because I don't know nobody to come out the way they did. I could walk out, you know, and somebody would say, hey, there's so-and-so, there's so-and-so. That carried on throughout as far as, it didn't stop at Linden as far as those people was what they was doing. Oh, and Bill Moss. Oh, man. Whew. You see, because I was blackballed after that Linden. I couldn't get no teaching job back in Columbus. And Bill Moss, he lived in my area. I lived in Franklin Park. And Bill lived up the street from me. And I would always see, Bill would always walk in Franklin Park, and I would see him. And I got to know him and all that. And then when he's on school board and all that, Bill would talk to me and say, man, black kids need you. He said, man, don't you think about, man, trying to get back in? I said, well, Bill, man, they ain't going to get me back in. Bill said, look, I am going to get you back in. I said, Bill, if you do that, if you can, okay. So Bill started contacting different people. This is what I'm saying, you know, you need help. And Bill contacted Stacy Wolford, and Stacy's another one. Those two guys, you know, they got me back in. And I just think about those guys, man, and you know, it's good.
Teacher, you know that the students didn't know? What were you aware of? What did you know? I mean, I know you were an adult and they were still mm-hmm. kids, but what did you know that they didn't know?
Wow, that's what did I know they didn't know? Only thing I knew was I knew that some of the teachers that they thought was good was stabbing them in the back. I knew that. But I would never go up to them and say, you know, just watch this teacher or nothing like that, you know. And let me bring up the point, like, every black teacher ain't black. And I could smile in your face and stab you in the back. Some people are put there to keep you in check. In other words, you know, some people were put there to be the overseer to keep you on the plantation. And when you go to them and give them information, that information gets put out to somebody else who's going to use it against you. So be careful who you talk to. I would just tell the kids that. Be careful who you confide in. You know, some things you don't even want to tell me. Because if it's something I got to report, I'm going to tell you up front. You know, I can recall one time when I was teaching over at East. And this girl was, nice girl, but she didn't play. She didn't take no mess. No, couldn't nobody handle her, and they gave her to me. So one time, she came into my class about early in the morning. And she said, I got to tell you something. I said, okay. I said, if you tell me, if it's something wild, you know, I got to report it. She said, I just got robbed. I said, coming to school. I said, yeah. I said, what'd they get? She said, they got $600 off of me. I said, what you doing with $600? She said, well, that's all right, Mr. Bunch. They got $600 off of me. And I'm gonna get it back after I leave. I said, look, don't tell me nothing else. You know, because what you talking about, I got to report that if something happens to you. She said, oh, no. I said, no. Nah. I said, you know, don't tell me. So you just got to be careful how you deal with these kids. And that was, you don't know what you don't know what you are dealing with. Because the Combs, you know, and this kid came from a good home. This girl I'm talking about. So those kids at Linden, they was almost like they was becoming adults before they were becoming adults. They had to make decisions on their own that was going to affect them for the rest of their life. And a lot of these kids, you know, like, I got about 7 or 8 of them now on Facebook. Contact me. And they doing good.
Since you say that, can you talk, are there any individuals from that group that stand out to you? I know you mentioned John Wells before, and John Whitaker, John Harrington, Valora Washington, Zola Diggs, Al Young, Donald Vassar. Do any of those names, do you have memories of any of those students?
I had a young man. Yeah, I had a young man. His name is Derrick Coles. He was, I took him out like a young kid. And he was just brilliant. He was so smart that he could take over my class. You know, and I don't know what happened to him. But he, I don't know what happened to him.
I'm gonna ask you to hold
okay.
On. So until the ringer stops, because you can't, it'll, the sound will be picked up.
Now, he was in my class, and he was part of that group, but he was younger. A lot of those other, like John and them, were seniors. Derek was like a sophomore, I think. And he could take over a meeting with them kids and just dominate. And his mind was black oriented. And he married a girl. And when you mention that type of situation, this girl, the girl he married, they got a divorce. But the girl he married contacted me yesterday on Facebook. All these years, all these people she contacted me. And I'm about ready to get back with her and let her know, you know, I want to know what Derek is doing right now. But that young man was just, so there were so many people that you will have to think about. I don't know. I don't know. You know, I forget so many of them. But some of them just stand out. You just can't forget. I mean, I'll do it. Yeah, give me.
It's not that we didn't like the ringer, which was such a cool tool, by the way. We loved it.
Say something. My bag. I'm sorry.
That's all right. It's all right. So I want to ask you, for yourself, how did your time at Linden affect your pathway forward?
It just kept my attitude on trying to be pro-black, sticking with that. You know, I can pick up people very easily, the ones that come across phony. It prepared me for that. You know, like, I don't just trust everybody. Always try to help out. You know, my attitude is try to find, like, a black doctor, black dentist. If I need some work on my house, if I find somebody that's black doing that, I ain't going to be taking for no food now. You know, like, if a person is going to double the price on me and he's black, you got to go. But I try to find somebody that's black. I try to tell other people that has a black business, try to tell other people about them. Even the people that that I know when I was teaching at East, if they would ask me, what teacher should I get for my kid? I would tell them. And I said, hey, this is the teacher you want to give. And you go see guidance counselor, pick this teacher out. This is the one you need, because this other teacher ain't going to be good for your kid. You're going to keep your kid away from getting a scholarship. So this I try to look out for other people. That's the way it affected me.
Okay. And you mentioned something about being blackballed also after your time at Linden for a while. And you said that you didn't, I know you mentioned that Bill Moss helped you out, but can you talk about being blackballed and why you think that happened?
That was because of the Linden situation. Very simple. You know, I didn't have enough time in to really get a 4-year contract, so they could easily get rid of me. And I could sub, but I never get a full-time job. And so after Bill and Stacy did what they did, when I went back down there, and I forgot the man's name, he said, you know, like, Stacy and Bill Moss were highly recommended, you know, all that. So he came across like, I ain't gonna say he wanted me to say something like, we don't want no trouble, nothing like that, but my mind is interpreting like, I hope this man ain't telling me I gotta change my attitude, nothing like that. Cause if that's the case, I ain't even gonna take it. But I looked at him, I said, I'm gonna be teaching. I'm gonna be teaching. I just left it at that. So I remember I went to a school, it was a Warner Ridge, and this is a white principal. And I was teaching, and I was talking to these kids, and I was coming across, I was subbing. And he didn't like the way I was coming across. He was getting reports. Now, I guess some white kids, they didn't like what I was saying. So he came up. He said, well, he said, Mr. Bunch, I don't think you might not be a good fit here. Now, my kids was going there, my own kids. And I said, well, okay. I said, you're the principal. That ain't no problem. So they sent me back downtown. So, this man, the man downtown told me, the man that was over everything, during the hunt, he looked at me, he said, that was my mistake. He said, I never should have sent you out there with that man. And I looked at him. He said, we've had some problems with him, with some other black teachers. He said, that's my fault. So, it's the first time I'm having a conversation with this man, with a white man like this, say that. Now, and my thinking was, my kids go to that school. So my son was, he was in the running for the valedictorian at that school. And all of a sudden, it's close between him and this white boy. All of a sudden, they came up with this rule that, well, it's so close, we're going to have to change the way we pick a valedictorian this year. Now, the man knew that's my son. And, the man he done got rid of. So, my son, I just told him, I said, look, you're a couple points ahead of him. Do what you got to do. Don't worry about it. So, at the end of the year, my son finished number one. He got the valedictorian of the school. And we went out there, and I knew that man hated it. And I went to the assembly that time. I walked in there to the assembly with Bill Moss. I knew that man hated to call my son name, but he had to, He had no choice. So I put this out on Facebook. I put this out maybe a couple years ago, last year or something. And I was talking about what I'm just telling you. About my son, I said, yeah, for you people that was trying to hold my son back from getting that valedictorian, I just want you to know that he went to a black school, Hampton, and he graduated with a 3.9 and in chemical engineering, and he got his PhD from Ohio State in chemical engineering. So, you ain't got to be sorry that you gave him that valedictorian. You can kiss my black ass. And that's the way I put it. So I don't care about them, that's just me.
Right on. Thank you for that. That's an amazing story. So I guess, I want to wrap up with asking you your thoughts on the demonstrations that we're seeing this year, especially against police brutality and racial violence. You said something earlier that actually made me think of this, too. You talked about how at Lyndon, there was an effort made to blame the students who were trying to organize and get some constructive things done. They were blamed for the trouble, for the people who were just being opportunistic and trying to lash out. And so I think about now, with the, we have demonstrations and then we have looting. Mm-hmm. There's two different groups of people doing And so I wondered if you could just tell us your thoughts about the demonstrations, which have been heavily, you know, it's been a lot of young people, a lot more than, you know, I remember seeing in any other time. Just talk to us about that and how you think, and especially when you reflect on the things that happened at Lyndon.
Well, you know, like, I feel what's going on today, because, you know, like, well, in all my life, I've never seen the change in the white kids the way they are now. And to me, if you get the support of the black white kids the way they are now, that's going to bring the change. If it's just black people by themselves, there's not going to be no change. We've been trying to change for 400 years, ain't nothing happening. If you get those white kids involved the way they are now, that's going to be the change. You know, it's almost like when you start having integrated schools and having discussions on race issues with white and blacks, when them white kids go home and start bringing it to them white parents, that's where the change is going to come. You can't have the discussions on black issues with just black people. We already know them. It's got to be with the white people, and they got to talk and say, this is why we're doing this, and what can you do to improve that? And when them young white kids start doing that, this is when we're going to have change, period. That's how I see it. And, you know, like this rally today that I was having in D.C., if they got a whole bunch of white people there, that's going to improve that whole environment up there. You got to have them white people, the young ones. You can't have them old ones like me trying to. They ain't gonna change. You know that's not gonna change.
Are you surprised, or have you been surprised at the level of the response in general to the incidents that we have? That we've seen, the murder of George Floyd, and we didn't see it, but, you know, the murder of, the killing of Sandra Bland, the death of Sandra Bland, and Breonna Taylor, and now we have, you know, Jacob Blake, who is not, he wasn't killed, but who was assaulted brutally with a gun police. Are you surprised at seeing the level of response to that, people actually out in the street, and being out there, you know, every day, even though it's not on the news every day.
Right, no. You know, like, I think, you know, like, this is one of the things I like about Facebook is that you got white people that read your stuff. So when I put stuff out there, it's not just for black people. I want you to read what I'm putting out there, too. And when I put something out like, I say, when you white people get up in the morning, all you got to do to look for is when the sun's going to come up. When a black person gets up in the morning, they got to look out and say, am I going to make it through the day without getting shot? That's how the whole attitude is. So until they understand that, until you step in my shoes, you ain't going to understand it. But, you know, like when you see all these white people taking their gun and pointing them at the police, or hitting the police, or cussing at the police, and they don't get, you need to see that on Facebook. You see, now you see why black people get upset? Look what you do to them. Just do the same thing to me, and we'd be even. We'd be straight. If you treat me like you treat him, I ain't got, you know, I'm not the type of black person that wants to try to invade, like Trump's invade your suburbs. I don't need to live in the suburbs. I don't need to send my kids to your white school. We got schools just as good. Have you seen the black suburbs in Atlanta? Are you crazy? Black people are doing it. So don't come across like we're trying to invade. Just treat us the same as you treat everybody else. We'll have no problem. If I need a job and I'm going against this person, if my qualifications equal him, fine. Don't give it to him because he's white. The only thing I can see is it's got to come from up in D.C., the government, through legislation. You know, like, we got the Black Caucus, but they need to get support from them white senators. You know, even if Joe Biden wins, if we don't get the Senate and O'Connell still there, we're still in the same boat. We're still in the same boat. I look at, you know, people keep talking about this person doing winning this, a black person doing that. To me, it's the Supreme Court. Them judges rule everything. They can change anything they want. They got lifetime appointments. Until we get some black people, we don't have, to me, we don't have a black person on the Supreme Court. We don't have one. We got one, got a black mask on, a permanent black mask on, that's it. So until we get some people, if Biden gets in and get a black woman on Supreme Court or a black man, whatever, that's where the changes are going to come. The legislator, if we can get the House and the Senate and get some, and you know, like they're talking about police reform, it's got to come from them, that party. It's got to come from the Senate and the House, and then Biden signed it. That's where the change is going to come. Biden get in, Biden going to say, hey, look, everybody wear a mask. Forget what Trump said. Everybody wear a mask. If you don't, this is what's going to happen. Now, that's leadership. We ain't got that now. So until we get that change of all three branches of the government, we just out there. That's what I think.
Yeah, well.
Yeah.
So just wanted to say it was really a fantastic interview to both of you. Sorry if you can't see me well. Just give me 1 second.
I can see your shadow.
Sorry, I had to mute myself while I talked to my automated devices to turn my lights on. But I just have to say, you know, it was really wonderful to both of you. What a great interview. It was so just engaging and powerful. And Mr. Bunch, you brought such an interesting and different perspective. You know, we talked to several folks, and I'm sure Celia, you know, will tell you this, that you offer a really different perspective than the students. It's powerful. And, you know, my interest, frankly, is in the overall project first, but then also in learning to look at the literacy practices of the students who participated and to really look at the intersection between their activism, right, and the literacy practices. And so what I've been asking each of them is if there was anything that they read along the way or heard, you know, related to something written or perhaps something they wrote themselves that had a particular impact that inspired them to get involved with activism. But I realized you probably passed out a lot of those reading assignments. And so I wonder if you might be able to talk to that. Do you think there's anything among the reading assignments that you delivered to your students that might have inspired them to become involved in activism?
It's hard to give them reading assignments when you didn't have books on the subject of black history. So we had to tell them, we were bringing in stuff and we would run stuff off. And, you know, I would do things, and I wasn't like your normal teacher. You know, I ain't gonna lie to you. If I'm going to discuss something like the Willie Lynch letter, I would go up to the teacher's lounge, I would run off enough copies for all my students to have it, and then I would pass them out as they hear. And then that type of thing, you know, you would tell them, like, okay, go to the library and look up this. Get this encyclopedia and look up this, and then come back and tell us what you read. And tell the whole class what you read. You got to go out on your own, go to the library and look up these things that we're talking about to make sure you understand what you're talking about. Because we didn't know there was no such, we had a man from Cleveland bring us an encyclopedia of black books. And this was given to me and Gary and when the librarian had them. But that's all we had, but we didn't have enough books to give to every student. So we would have to use that. So it was like bringing in different speakers. If you're trying to get across as far as making them more black awareness, it would be like when they came to my class, my black history class, I told them, there's 48 of you. We need discipline. So when you first come in, I'm going to say, Assalamu alaikum. Now, when I would say that, that means I want peace. Then at the end of the class, I would say, Wa alaikum salam. So that was every day. So you got to make sure what you're telling them, they believe it. If they don't believe it, ain't no need telling them.
Wow, thank you. That was powerful. I really appreciate that. I'd like to ask you, you mentioned guest speakers. Any in particular you remember that had an impact?
Nobody would touch him, and he was surprised. I told him I wanted him to come to school. That was No More X. And I had him come, and the white principal got upset, and lucky the black assistant principal said, you know, hey, this man is a good man. What he's telling them kids, he's keeping them straight. So No More came to my class a couple times to talk. He was about the main one. I mean, I really appreciated him, cause he wasn't phony, and he was telling them kids, you know, you got to stay in school and you got to treat each other right.
Can you explain who he was?
No More X was a leader in the black community, mainly on the East Side and Afrocentric. And they used to meet over there on Livingston Avenue. I think he went on and got his PhD and everything. He just died, I think, maybe a couple of years ago. Very Afrocentric. Dr. Kelsey from Ohio State kind of really, really mentored him to go on to become something. And some people have just like this voice, like they should be on radio. You know, like Jim Robinson from Lazarus. And No More had that voice, you know, like he should be on radio. Came across clear and straight and black minded. That's the way that, you know, this is a beautiful brother.
Yeah, a lot of the ministers in the Nation of Islam, I think, who modeled themselves, you know, first after Malcolm X, had some really, I've seen that too in my home city as well. Mm-hmm. I came here and I met Brian X. There are many brothers who are just exceptional speakers, well prepared for that. I'd like to ask you one more. Thank you for sharing that too. Mm-hmm. And I think that what's really powerful is that you keep emphasizing, you know, authenticity, people with genuine, real commitment, you know, and that's come up a lot. And I wanted to ask you, so I was thinking about how to approach this and to find out what inspired you to get so involved with students in this way. And I recognize that it's, you know, part of your training, you're an educator, right? But then, you know, perhaps even after you got there, there was this continued professional growth and experiences as an educator. But I guess what I really want to get at is, were there any things in your literacy practices, things that you read or heard or wrote yourself along the way that inspired you to take on these roles with your students? And I recognize that, you know, it may be more than that. It might have been the experiences you had there, but that's what I really want to get at. In your training, along the way, you know, what was it that you read that affected you and made you want to become this kind of teacher who is so engaged and becomes more than a teacher, but an advocate and an advisor to their students?
I think you got to have, somebody that you can talk to, and somebody that's going to tell you the truth and be straight with you. And, you know, like when I went to Central State, and people kept talking about this teacher named Art Thomas. And Art Thomas had a class that was taught at night. And I'm thinking, man, I ain't taking no night class. So finally, one of my boys got me to take it. And this man, he was just cold. I mean, I took about two classes from him. And I would have took a class if he was teaching at 11 o'clock at night. I would have took it. He just made you think that, you know, when you get with these black kids, if you ain't helping them out, you ain't helping yourself. And if you can't see growth in them, you ain't doing your job. So being with people like him, just stuck. And then, like I said, when I finally got here, I finally got with some people. But Columbus was a funny city. My type of city is Dayton, Ohio. Even today, I should have stayed in Dayton. I mean, I don't know if you know anything about Dayton. It was the west side of Dayton is all black during that time. All black. I mean, the black schools, Roosevelt, and all that type of thing. The people, oh, man, it was just beautiful. But I came to Columbus. And the atmosphere here as far as the black people was kind of off at first. You know, in Dayton, I would see somebody and they would, hey, brother, how you doing? Hey, sister. I come to Columbus and I said, hey, brother. He would look at me like, do we have the same last name? What you mean, brother? And I'm thinking, damn, I mean, what's going on up here? It took me a while to integrate with our own kind up here. So that's about all I can say. I still have problems getting used to Columbus.
Hey, I have to say, you're right about that. When I first arrived in Columbus in the late 90s, I found it to be cliquish. But it's what you described. You know, you walk by someone and you're used to, from the East Coast, you're like, what's up, brother? Yeah. And people look at you funny. And so it was different for me, you know? And I remember that. I used to talk about it to my wife. Like, what's going on? Did you do something?
Like I went one time, I said, "Assalamu alaikum" to a brother. He said, "I ain't African." I said, "Oh man, forget it, man." I said, "That's all right, man."
See, that's a different perspective, isn't it? Let me throw in my. I want to be really considerate of your time, but I want to ask you this. I want to scroll back to that one point because the question was long, and I do want to come back to the point. Was there anything in particular that you remember reading that affected you, made you wanted to be the kind of teacher that you? The kind of advocate
well,
that you are.
Well, you know, reading the autobiography of Malcolm X, I read that about 3 or 4 times. And then there was this book named by Sam Yete. It was called The Choice. Oh, man, that book was just dynamic. And, I mean, reading that book, The Choice, it even evolved about this. He had something about the city of Dayton. Now, what I do now is, like, I'm a vendor. I usually sell to the AKAs. When they have shows, I take stuff there to go sell. My wife's an AKA and all that, so I got involved in that. And one time I was doing a show in Indianapolis, an AKA regional, and they have different people come around. And so I'm walking around now looking, this guy was selling the book, and it was the man who wrote The Choice. He was, oh man, I talked to that man. I almost lost my sales because I kept talking to him. Just so happy to see people like that. You know, I've never thought I would meet, man, this man. I said, man, your book is the bomb. Oh man. So just them two books right there, you know, got me rolling. And then, you know, you got people. From, like when you mentioned, you know, you got, like when she mentioned, people that come from New York, Philly, the black people that come from D.C. and Detroit, their mindset to me seems to be much, much different than people that come from other cities in the country. You know, it's when you get around people like that who think alike, it can only improve you. You know, it can only improve your mind to where every time you talk, you always gain something from them. So, I just appreciate those people.
Lastly, any particular parts of that book, those books, because I'm not familiar with The Choice, but I'm really familiar with the autobiography of Malcolm X, and I remember him talking about his experiences with his teachers. Mm-hmm. In school, I remember him talking about language. I remember him, you know, talking about the changes in his life with regard to, like, the choices he was making and getting back on this right road and his sacrifice. And it particularly what stuck with me was his transformation in his language. And I'm wondering if there's any particular parts of this work, of these works, either one, that had an impact.
The only thing that really stuck out with me, which I even will tell my kids, I mean, I'm talking about the kids that I taught, would be don't ever think that you are better than anybody else. As far as, don't let the education think that you, I am better than you because you don't have a college degree. I said, look at Malcolm. He was in prison, you understand? And now he got people who got college degree paying him to come and speak to them. Now, don't think because you don't go to college, you can't become a success in life. Don't get that to your head. Don't look up to me because I got a college degree. You know, I ain't looking down on you because you don't have this. So keep that in mind and you'll be much better and always help somebody else come up. That's what I got. When I looked at Malcolm, I said, you know, this man was selling drugs. He was pimping and all of that. And for him to change the way he did and to come out with that mindset, any of you can do that if you put your mind to it. So that's all I can say about that, man.
Well, I think that was well said. Thank you, sir. Yeah. You know, I have to say, Mr. Munch, I would love to follow up with you and talk with you in more detail at a later time, but this has been fantastic.
Okay. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you, sir.
Well, thank you again, Mr. Munch. We appreciate you so much for being generous with your time. And walking us through these memories and reliving this part of your life, this has been amazing.